people of every nation, every color and creed, from ocean to ocean, let's join together as one great church with one great praise to our great and mighty God. Here we go.
Glory and honor, dominion,
now and forever.
Now and forever, the Lord God omnipotent reigneth with power.
The devil would like for us to be foaming at the mouth. I said the mountaintop experience represents the height to which God wants to lift all of us up. And yet, the valley experience shows us the very depths to which the devil wants to drag any of us down. We know that we are living in the last days. So why is it that the scribes teach? Why do they say that Elijah must first come?
Exceedingly abundantly above all you could ask or think, according to the power that worketh in you. In you, my God is able to do just what he said he would do. Hallelujah. And he's gonna fulfill every promise to you. So don't give up on God, 'cause he won't give up on you. He's able. Do you believe it? Do you receive it? My God is able. Everybody say, oh, yeah. Take it up one time. God able to do just what he said he would do. Everybody sing, and he's gonna fulfill every promise to you. Oh, don't give up on God, 'cause he won't give up on you. He's able, he is so able, more than able to me. Yes, he is. Oh, my God is able. Everybody say, oh, he's able. Everybody say, oh, he's able. Take it up one time. We say he's able, he's able, he's able. My God is able, he's able, he's able, he's able. Say yeah, he's able, He picked me up, turned me around, placed my feet on solid ground, he's able, he's able, he's able, yes he is. Don't give up on God, 'cause he won't give up on you. Yeah, don't give up, give up on God, he won't give up on you. Don't give up on God, 'cause he won't give up on you. Don't give up on God, 'cause he won't give up on you. Don't give up on God, 'cause he won't give up on you. He's able. Hallelujah, he's able. Thank you, Jesus.
If you have ever been to LAX or to the San Diego airport, if you are ever there to pick up a friend, a loved one, a relative, you may find that you will need to drive around and circle around in cycles because you are not allowed to park right there at the airport. So you're circling around in a form of waiting, in a form of waiting for your loved one who may be arriving. But as you do this, as you keep going, and then you find yourself back where you started, and you keep going, circling around. You want to make sure that you're circling around in the arrivals, because if you're circling around and yet you're not in arrivals, you might be looking for your guest in departures when they are in fact in arrivals. This system of going in circles is a very fascinating system, because as you look at the Elijah message, as you look at the waves of the Elijah message, permit me to suggest to you that the Elijah message has also come into this world in cycles, in cycles, in cycles. The first cycle is when the Tishbite himself, when he was preaching truth to power, and he was speaking against corrupt government, and he was speaking against Ahab and his rambunctious wife Jezebel, and he was unafraid to tell the truth like it is and to deliver a thus saith the Lord. So when we look at the ministry of Elijah the Tishbite, we see that God used Elijah as a prophet in a super powerful way to transmit the message of God. But then that's the first cycle, the cycle of the Tishbite. But then there is the second cycle. The Bible shows us that the Elijah message, or the spirit and power of Elijah, returned, and it came in another cycle. And this is the cycle of John the Baptist in the New Testament. Jesus affirms that the ministry of John the Baptist, the ministry of the forerunner to speak truth against power. As much as Elijah was able to speak truth against power, John was also speaking truth against power just before the coming of the Lord. While the ministry of Elijah was bringing a revival among the children of Israel, the ministry of John was to prepare the people for the first advent of Jesus Christ. So he was the forerunner, and he was making straight the way of the Lord so that people would be ready to receive the Messiah. And so John was the forerunner of Christ, and he came in the spirit and in the power of Elijah. So when we look at The third wave, the third cycle of this spirit and power of Elijah, it touches our time. Whereas Elijah spoke to Ahab and Jezebel, and John the Baptist may have spoken to Herod and Herodotus. But then the last Elijah wave, the spirit and power of Elijah in its third cycle, brings us to a place where we must preach truth to power, even if it means that we must speak against corrupt governments. So Elijah talked to Ahab and Jezebel, and John talked to Herodotus and Herod. And maybe in our time we may have to speak to Donald and to Melania, because this is the season of the spirit and power of the Elijah message. The book of Malachi, the fourth chapter, especially when you look at the last two verses, it tells us clearly and prophetically that he is sending again the spirit of Elijah before that great and dreadful day of the coming of the Lord. And this is what the spirit of Elijah will do. And the book of Malachi, in the last two verses of chapter 4, it tells us that he is going to turn the hearts of the fathers to the sons, and the hearts of the sons to the fathers. So the message of Elijah in the last days is going to return in a powerful way. There will be reconciliations that will take place between parents and their children, children and their parents. And notice that this wave of the Elijah message comes just before the great and the dreadful day of the Lord. When Elijah comes, he is going to turn the hearts of the fathers to their sons, and the hearts of the sons to their fathers. So this is going to be a message of reconciliation. And the Bible says this must happen before the great and the dreadful day of the coming of Jehovah. Or else, he would strike the earth. He would strike the earth with utter destruction. So there must be reconciliation that happens. Because you know what? The Bible shows us clearly that God does not take pleasure in the death of the wicked or the death of the unrighteous. Amos chapter 3 verse 7 also tells us that God does not do anything unless he first warns through his servants, the prophets. We are living in a time period before a great and a cataclysmic event takes place, before Jesus returns to this planet. And before that happens, the Bible says Elijah must come. And Elijah is going to preach and bring reconciliation, not just of fathers to their sons, sons to their fathers, but of people back to their God. When Elijah the Tishbite used to preach to Israel, he was basically speaking a message of revival for Israel. And he was asking the children of Israel to turn away from wickedness, to turn away from the worship of Baals and come back to worshiping the true God. So the Elijah message, in essence, is a message that comes just before the return of the Lord Jesus Christ. So in the first cycle, we saw that it had to do with Israel's revival. In the second cycle, it had to do with John the Baptist preparing the people of God before Jesus would come. And we know that John the Baptist was the forerunner of the coming of the Messiah. So the Jews clearly understood that Elijah would come just before the coming of Christ. The Jews understood this as they studied scripture. The Pharisees understood that Jesus was going to be preceded by the coming of Elijah. The scribes understood that. all Bible prophets understood that Elijah would precede the coming of the Messiah. But you see, the Jews expected that Elijah would come literally. The Tishbite would return. See, the Jews expected the literal return of Elijah the Tishbite. But that's not what God prophesied in the book of Malachi. The book of Malachi is not telling us about the physical reincarnation or the return in the flesh of a man called Elijah. So they lived in that season of anticipation that Elijah the prophet, the Tishbite, would return just before the coming of the Messiah or the coming of the Christ. The book of Matthew in the 16th chapter tells us that this is the prevailing notion. This is the imagination and the thinking of the Jewish people. So Jesus is curious and he says to his disciples, who do people say that I am? Who do they say that I am? What's the word on the street about me? And the responses were like, some say that you're John the Baptist. Because you see, John the Baptist had already been beheaded for speaking truth to power, for speaking against Herod and Herodotus. And so they responded by saying, some say that you are John the Baptist. And some say you are Elijah. Some say you are Elijah. And others even think that you are Jeremiah or one of the prophets. And Jesus pressed the question further. And he said, but who do you say that I am? And Simon, the son of Jonah, Simon bar Jonah, the Bible tells us that flesh and blood did not reveal it to him because he said, you are the Christ. You are the Son of the living God. And Christ did tell him that it wasn't flesh and it wasn't his imagination. It wasn't his understanding, his computation or his intellect that revealed that to him. But the Spirit of God, God in heaven, made it known clearly to Simon bar Jonah that this here is the Son of God. This is the awaited for Messiah. So, if the Messiah has already come, we therefore understand that preceding the Messiah, John the forerunner, John the Baptist, was doing the work of the forerunner, preparing people for the coming of the Messiah. So we know that John was heralding the message of Elijah before the first advent of Jesus Christ. The first cycle of the Elijah message was bringing a revival among the children of Israel. The second cycle of the Elijah message, just like the first, was bringing a revival among the people of God and calling people to the true worship of God and to the expectation of the Savior, the expectation of the Messiah or the expectation of the Christ. And you do remember that when John the Baptist was baptizing, he did declare that this is the one that whose sandals that he is not even worthy to undo. You remember John saying, behold the Lamb of God, which taketh away the sins of the world. He was basically declaring that Christ was the promised Savior. Christ was the root of David, the very expected Messiah who would deliver people from the bondage of their sins. And we know that John the Baptist was also preaching just like Elijah, turning the hearts of fathers to their children and children's hearts to their fathers. A message of reconciliation is the kind of message that John preached in the spirit and in the power of Elijah. Another key incident that is important for us to understand is what transpired at the Mount of Transfiguration. You remember that Jesus has left his disciples. He leaves 9 disciples in the valley and he takes 3 up the mountain with him. He takes Peter and James and John and they get up there for the reason of prayer. And while they are right there at the top of the mountain, the Bible tells us that Jesus is transfigured. He changes form and his raiment looks like light, and his garments are so white. The Bible says like no launderer on earth could whiten. And he was glorified in that form right in front of them. And to make matters even more complex, not only does Jesus get transformed into this magnificent light, Elijah shows up and Moses shows up. And they start talking to Jesus, and Peter and James and John are so intimidated. They are so scared when they see this incident. In fact, they are trembling, and they hear the voice of God declaring that this is his son. This is his beloved son in whom he is well pleased. You know, the presence of Moses in this Transfiguration Mountain is very important. It's very important to all of us as believers. All of us who may be suffering from the coronavirus, or all of us who might be at death's door because of other ailments, it's very important for us to understand that Moses, though he died, he was seen right at the Mount of Transfiguration. In other words, even though Moses died, even though Israel mourned the death of Moses, Moses being seen on the Mount of Transfiguration is evidence of somebody else other than Jesus Christ, somebody else other than Lazarus, who was resurrected from the dead. So Moses represents any of us who may die before Jesus comes. And Moses is seen at the Mount of Transfiguration, at this mountaintop experience, because he represents those who will die in Jesus and yet be resurrected in Jesus. Elijah, on the other hand, is a fascinating character seen right there in Matthew chapter 17 in the narrative of the Transfiguration. He too appears. But we know that Elijah never tasted death. Elijah went up to heaven in a chariot of fire. He never experienced death. He was never dead, nor was he ever buried. Elijah does not know what it is to die. And yet the Bible shows us that the one who knew what it's like to die, Moses, and the one who never knew what it's like to die, Elijah, both were seen on the Mount of Transfiguration. Moses represents those of us who will die and will be resurrected in the name of Jesus, in that first resurrection that we have talked about in previous parts. But Elijah represents those of us who are alive today. Should Jesus arrive right now, while we are yet alive, many of us will not taste death. So Elijah represents those who will be translated at the appearance of Jesus, and they will not taste death. So it's pivotal that Christ is talking to Moses, and he's also talking to Elijah. But I want to explain also this mountaintop experience, the mountain where they have climbed, and Jesus is glorified, and his raiment is like light, and his face is like light. His garments are so white, like no launderer on earth could make them. This happens at the mountaintop experience because it represents the very heights to which God wants to lift all of us up. He wants to lift all of us to a place where we are even transformed and translated and glorified into the very image of God. That's what this mountaintop experience represents. But you remember that when you come down that mountain, you can read this in Mark chapter 9, you can read this in Matthew chapter 17. When they came down into the valley, there was chaos in the valley. The Bible tells us that there was a young man in the valley who was sick. And the Bible says he was possessed of a spirit, and the spirit would sometimes cast the kid in the fire, sometimes cast the kid in the water to destroy the kid. And this had happened to the child since childhood. And Jesus comes down and finds that there is chaos in the valley. I said the mountaintop experience represents the heights to which God wants to lift all of us up. And yet, the valley experience shows us the very depths to which the devil wants to drag any of us down. The devil would like for us to be foaming at the mouth. The devil would like for us to be twitching. The devil would like for us to be filled with spirits that overpower us and want to destroy us in fires and destroy us in waters. But God wants to lift us up and take us to the mountaintop experience. So then the disciples who were up there with Jesus, Peter and James and John, who asked the question, why then, this is Matthew chapter 17 in verse 10, why then do the scribes say Elijah must first come? And that's a very good question. It's a question that many of us ask even in this year in which we live. We know that we are living in the last days. So why is it that the scribes teach and show from scripture, as we already looked at the two verses in Malachi chapter 4, the last two verses of that chapter, Elijah must come. Why do the scribes teach? Why do they say that Elijah must first come? It's a good question. It's a good question. We are not expecting Elijah in the flesh. Listen to how Jesus answered. The Bible says Jesus told them that Elijah has already come. And the Bible says those who were listening knew that Jesus was speaking of John the Baptist. So the first cycle of the Elijah message is preached by the Tishbite himself. The second cycle of the spirit and power of the Elijah message is preached by John the Baptist. But this final cycle, this cycle in these end times, in these times when we are surrounded by pandemics and pestilences and times of trouble like no man has ever experienced, jobs being lost and the economy affected and disease rampant and hospitals filled to the brim with sicknesses and grave dangers. Doctors and nurses and frontline people affected by disease. As we live in these last days, the Bible says the message of Elijah will be preached again in the spirit and power of Elijah. And this is the message that we will preach with power before the return of our Lord and our Savior, Jesus Christ. We will preach a message fearlessly and speak truth even to power, just like did Elijah, just like did John the Baptist. And in these last days, there will be people of God who will say, and thus saith the Lord, fearlessly. This is a message of reunion. This is a message of reconciliation. This is a message that turns the hearts of fathers to their sons and the hearts of sons to their fathers. This is a message of reconciliation of families. Why? Because Jesus is soon to come. There must be reconciliation. You need to kiss and make up with your children. You need to kiss and make up and have peace with your siblings. There is need for reconciliation before Jesus comes. It's a message that precedes the destruction of wicked people. I don't want to be on the wicked side, and I don't want to be destroyed. So, parents, I said, kiss, make up with your children. That is the Elijah message. Why? Because Jesus is soon to come. Signs are telling us everywhere. I mean, you would be crazy not to see that every sign is being fulfilled. Jesus is soon to come. You can tell from signs everywhere that Jesus is soon to come. So what is the Elijah message? Get ready. Get ready. Get ready for the coming of the Lord. So this is the last cycle of the Elijah message. And it is preached in the spirit and in the power of Elijah. Because it must be heart stirring. People's hearts need to be turned not only in social reconciliation, but also in the reconciliation of the people of God back to God. Now you know that Elijah made people choose between God and Baal. So we are living in a day and age where we must make a choice between the true God or continue in the worship of false gods. The name Elijah itself means Yahweh is my God. My God is Yahweh. You need to make your own declaration and confess with your own mouth that Yahweh or Jehovah is our God. So the very name Elijah is a name that brings us to making a decision for God, the true God, to be our God before the great and the dreadful day of the coming of the Lord. That day need not be dreadful. That day needs to be a great and a marvelous and an exciting day when we receive the Lord and we say, this is our God. We have waited for him and now he has come to take us. Receive the message of Elijah.